Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to never miss an update from Rouse IAS.
Hello and welcome to Daily News Simplified, an answer to what, why and how of newspaper reading. Today we'll be taking up the Delhi edition of the Hindu newspaper dated 17th April 2021. Now the articles to be discussed are reflected on your screen and the time stamping has been provided in the description box below. So now let's begin. So now, as you all must have seen, this is the largest article appearing in today's newspaper, as is seen in page number 7, and it talks about various things. Now the first and the most important thing that this article talks about is the security issue that the Mizoram state has been facing. Now this is mostly in respect to the smuggling issues with respect to smuggling of drugs such as meth, gold, arms and ammunition. Further, there is issue of illegal crossing of the borders that is porous between India and Myanmar. And further, it also talks about the much delayed project of the Kaladan Multimodal Transit Project. Now, in this article, as we move forward, we'll take up all these issues one by one. From the mains point of view, that is the GS paper 3 point of view, we'll discuss the security issues of Northeast India in general and Mizoram in particular. Further, we'll talk about the security setup of the Northeast that is helping curb these issues that we just discussed. And last, from the prelims point of view, we will discuss the Kaladan Multimodal Project that is soon to reach its completion. So now let's begin the discussion of this article. Now, Kaladan Multimodal Project, as envisaged between the Government of India and the Government of Myanmar, in 2008, is basically a sea, river and land connectivity project, wherein the complete funding of the project, that is rupees 20,000 crore, will be undertaken by Government of India via the Ministry of External Affairs. Now this project has three legs. The first leg is of 539 kilometers that connects Kolkata to the Sitwe port of Myanmar. The second leg talks about the riverine connectivity between Sitwe port and Paletwa, that is the city of Myanmar. And the third leg is about road connectivity between Paletwa to Zorinpuri border crossing. And at last is one more aspect to this project that brings back connectivity to India, wherein the Zorinpuri border crossing would be connected back to Mizoram at Zorinpuri. So basically this project has three legs. First is the sea legs or the shipping leg. Second is with respect to inland waterways. And third, and also a small part, that is the fourth part, is with respect to land connectivity via roadways. Now this project was originally conceptualized to be launched by 2014. However, 7 years down the line, this project has still not completed and is expected to be complete by 2023. Now this delay in the project has various implications. Now the first implication, as we can all understand, is with respect to cost overruns. Now it has been estimated that by far the cost of the project has gone up by 3200 crores, that is as much as 16% of the overall project cost, which is huge given India alone has been bearing the overall cost of this project, and this overall burden of total increase in the cost will also be borne by India. Now, next important implication is with respect to dent in India's image. For delay in project delivery hurts India's strategic interest in the region, as it is not seen as a reliable development partner. And instead, what happens is that countries in India's neighborhood move towards China for development-related help. Now, it has been estimated that China has made as much as $20 billion investment in Myanmar by the year of 2018. Now, as you can clearly see, China has been trying to ingress in India's neighborhood via means of checkbook diplomacy. India, while cannot compete with China with respect to its financial strength and its hard power diplomacy, what India can do best here is to use its soft power to bring back and win back its neighbor. One of the most important aspects of which is timely delivery of development projects. Now, this will not only help build India's image as a reliable development partner, but will also provide its neighbor an alternative to move away from China's debt-trap diplomacy that is causing all these countries to fall into China's debt, as has been specially seen in the case of Sri Lanka, that had to lease out the Hambantota port for 99 years to China. And in this regard, India's image as a reliable development partner is not only good for its own well-being, but is also good for overall regional's well-being. Now, moving on to the third implication with respect to the delays in the Kaladan multimodal project, and this is with respect to security implication. Now, as we all know, in the recent times, Myanmar has been facing a military coup wherein the Myanmar government has been overtaken by its military. And this creates a huge problem for India. For India is the world's largest democracy and it cannot ever support a military coup. But on the other hand, the Myanmar military has been very important for countering the insurgency that India has been facing with respect to India-Myanmar border. And hence, here India faces a problem of delicate balancing between its commitment to democratic credentials and its security mandate. And thus, you can see the varied implications that this delay is going to cost to India. However, still this Kaladan multimodal project holds a lot of significance for India even after the delay in the completion. So now let us try to see the significance that this project holds for India, Myanmar and the South Asia region in general. Now for India, this corridor holds three key significance. Now the first significance is with respect to reducing burden over the Siliguri corridor, which is also known as the chicken neck, for it represents this narrow stretch that connects the mainland India with the rest of Northeast India. And thus, as we all can imagine, this Siliguri corridor, also known as the chicken neck corridor, holds a lot of strategic importance for India. Now, this Kaladan multimodal project will help overcome the burden that this corridor is presently facing, for it will bring down the distance that India mainland has with the rest of India, that is the Northeast India. And it has been estimated that it would reduce the distance between Kolkata and Assam by as much as 50%, which is huge. And thus, this is one of the greatest significance that this multimodal project holds for India. Further, it will boost connectivity for Northeast, as we have already discussed, that will bring along not only economic development but will also bring enhanced intermingling between these two India and will reduce the alienation that these Northeast Indians feel in their own country. And finally, this corridor will also help India counter China's ingress in its neighborhood. Now, China, as we had discussed earlier, has been trying to make ingress in its various neighbors such as Nepal, Bhutan, Myanmar, Sri Lanka, etc., wherein it has been using its economic might to influence the policy decisions, the connectivity of the region. And hence, in this regard, India's initiative with respect to Kaladan multimodal project will counter these tendencies of China. Now, moving on to the significance this project holds for Myanmar. Now, for Myanmar, this project will result in development of Sitwe port that falls in the Rakhine state. Now, the Rakhine state is where the Rohingya population of Myanmar lives. And the Rohingya, as we all know, are the most persecuted minority in the world. And they have been facing what UN calls a classic case of ethnic cleansing in the Buddhist country of Myanmar. And as a result of which, there has been an exodus of Rohingyas towards Bangladesh, India's northeast region, as well as India's mainland. Now, in order to counter this, the project could be really helpful given it will lead to development of this Rakhine region by promoting economic, commercial and strategic development of this region. Now, moving on to the impact that this project will have on South Asia in general. Now, this Kaladan Multimodal Transit Transport Project has often been hailed by India as its future gateway to the Northeast region. Now, this project will boost the connectivity of India with its extended neighborhood and Thailand, bringing India closer to the ASEAN region alongside the RCEP region. And hence this project holds a lot of importance both for India, its neighborhood and its extended neighborhood in terms of boosting connectivity, which shall end up promoting the economic development of overall region. And hence the Kaladan project holds a lot of significance for the region in general. Now let us move to the next topic. Now moving on towards the security issue that affect these 8 northeastern states. Now these 8 northeastern states in together constitute culturally and diverse 200 ethnic groups that have different dialects, different language and even different social cultural identities. Now because of these massive diversities that lie at their very core, these groups have never been friendly to each other and have had a long history of conflicts and violence, because of which this region has always seen ethno-nationalism. Now, ethno-nationalism basically refers to violence and terrorism by sub-national ethnic groups so as to elevate their own status vis-a-vis other ethnic groups, or for demands such as autonomy or creation of a separate state. Now, this is highlighted in terms of the Mizo movement or the Naga movement that has been trying to create a greater Nagalim. Now this ethnic tension that has been pre-existing in this region has been furthered by the problem of the porous border. Now India shares the porous border with the state of Myanmar and Bangladesh. Because of the complex geography and difficult terrain, along with the courses of the river that keeps changing. Now this porous border has resulted in lot of unwanted immigration from the neighboring states, such as the migration that was seen after the 1971 Bangladesh war in states such as Assam has given rise to lot of ethnic tensions in this state. And hence it is one of the most important security concern when we talk of the northeastern state. Now, because of this porous border and enhanced immigration, there is what is known as the change of demography that has been witnessed in these states. And as a result of which, these states that have been predominantly tribal are today seeing lot of intrusion from the outsiders that are actually diluting their tribal culture. Next important concern is with respect to the trade of drugs. Now the northeastern states are very close to the golden triangle that originates from the state of Laos, Thailand and Myanmar, which is reflected in this region, that is the opium survey area. This is the region that is known as the golden triangle through which drugs and other illegal things flow into the country. And as a result of which, that has also been highlighted by the author, it is the state of Mizoram that is facing one of the highest addiction levels in the country. Now moving on to the next security issues, that is with respect to the existence of terrorist camp across the borders. Now India and Myanmar share what is known as the free movement regime that allows the tribals living along the border areas to travel as much as 16 km across the borders without need of a visa. But this movement, as we all can understand, is often misused by the insurgent groups who use these open borders to carry out attack and cross borders for escaping the authorities in both these countries. And hence this poses another important security challenge for the northeastern region. Now, in order to deal with this rising security issues of the northeast, government has undertaken various steps. Now, this policy measure of the government can be understood in terms of British carrot and stick policy, wherein carrot can be understood in terms of the negotiations that the government has been undertaking with these groups. Now, here government is trying to woo these groups to category abjure violence and seek solutions for their problem peacefully within the mandates of the constitution. Now, in this regard, government has introduced various schemes, such as the scheme for surrender and rehabilitation of militants in the northeast. Now, this is a scheme that has been launched by Ministry of Home Affairs, so as to bring back the misguided youth within the framework of the law and the constitution. Now, the second important scheme is the Civil Action Program in the Northeast. Now, this scheme aims to boost the confidence of the local populace in the armed forces. Now, because of the implementation of laws such as ASFA, the local populace has developed a very negative image of the law enforcement agencies, and hence this program aims to melt away that image and develop a positive image of the armed forces. The last is the policy of advertisement and publicity, wherein the student exchange programs are undertaken such that the youth of the northeastern states are taken to the mainland and vice versa. Further, when this carrot is not effective, the government has been using what is known as stick. Now, this is use of force to deal with insurgents. Herein, the government has been employing the Armed Forces Special Protection Act. It has been declaring groups as unlawful associations and terrorist organizations under Unlawful Activity Prevention Act. It has been further deploying Central Armed Police Forces and assisting state for modernization of state police forces. Given law and order is a state subject, hence center has been assisting these states in this regard. And lastly, to boost the efficacy of the forces, government has adopted the principle of one border, one guarding force. That is, the one border with one country will be guarded by only one force. As a result of which, Bangladesh-Pakistan border are being guarded by Border Security Force. China border is guarded by ITBP, that is Indo-Tibetan Border Police. In Nepal and Bhutan borders are being guarded by Shastra Seema Bal. And Myanmar border is being guarded by Assam Rifles. Now let us see what has been the impact of this policy measure of the government. Now, in front of you is the Ministry of Home Affairs annual report that is talking about the security situation in the Northeast over the period of 10 years. That is, how has the situation changed over the past one decade? Now, as you can see, there were total 1,297 incidents in the year 2009, which has dropped to 223. This is a massive reduction, and this is a clear indication of how effective the government strategy with respect to insurgents of the northeastern be. Now, similarly, with respect to other parameters such as extremists killed, extremists arrested, special forces killed, civilian killed, extremists surrendered, arms surrendered, there has been a massive reduction in the data point in the year 2019. And hence it can be said that there has been a substantial improvement in the situation in the northeastern states. The report suggests, especially with respect to last 6 years, there has been a significant decline in the insurgent incident. There has been reduction in the casualty of the police force, and also there have been less civilian deaths. 2019 has said to have recorded the lowest insurgency incident in past one decade. Further, it has been suggested that the four states of Tripura, Sikkim, Mizoram, there have been completely free from insurgency, and there have been a marked security improvement in other states. And at last, there have been a massive decline in the violence in these states in the past couple of years. So with this, we have understood that there has been a massive improvement with respect to the security situation of the Northeast. And hence, the measures undertaken by the government are bearing fruits. Now, this article appearing on the page number 8 has been written in the context of recent monsoon forecast by the IMD, that is Indian Meteorological Department. Now, the Indian Meteorological Department, that is an agency of Ministry of Earth Sciences, has in its recent prediction suggested that India is likely to receive normal monsoon in the present year. But what does one mean by normal monsoon, you ask? Now, normal monsoon in Indian context refers to the range within which rainfall happens each year. It can also be understood in terms of rainfall in millimeter or centimeter. Now, normal monsoon basically means a range of rainfall between 96% to 104% of a long-term average of 88 centimeter, which in numeric terms simply means that the rainfall should be between 84 centimeters to 91 centimeters. And hence, it is this range that is known as normal monsoon, which India is set to witness this year as per the IMD forecast. Further, the article suggests that in the past 2 years, that is the 2019 and 2020, India had witnessed above than normal monsoon. Now, there were two different factors that caused above than normal monsoon in these 2 years. Now, in 2019, the reason behind this was La Nina, about which we will study as we move forward. And in 2020, the reason was positive IOD. Again, this is something we will study as we move forward. However, in this year, it has been suggested that both these trends will not be witnessed, and as a result of which, India is likely to face normal monsoon. Further, it has been suggested that the IMD will be developing a separate forecast for what is known as monsoon core zones. Now, basically, monsoon core zones refer to the agriculture rainfed area, wherein the agriculture of the region is highly dependent on the monsoon conditions. And hence, it is because of this region that IMD has decided to develop special forecast for monsoon core zones. Now, as we all know, monsoon has been one of the most favorite topics of UPSC, because of which over the years we have seen a lot of questions that have been appearing around the monsoon phenomenon. Now, there was this question in 2017 that read, with reference to Indian Ocean Dipole, sometimes mentioned in the news while forecasting Indian monsoon, which of the following statement is or are correct? The first statement reads, IOD phenomenon is characterized by a difference in sea surface temperature between the tropical western Indian Ocean and the tropical eastern Pacific. Now, the second statement reads, an IOD phenomenon can influence an El Nino's impact on monsoon. Now, both these topics, that is the El Nino and the Indian Ocean Dipole, have been extensively in news in the recent past, because of which this question was framed. So in this article moving forward, let us try to revise the monsoon phenomenon in India and the recent events such as the La Nina and the positive IOD, and what do they entail for the Indian monsoon. Now, Indian monsoon phenomenon, as depicted in this diagram, is basically a seasonal reversal of winds. Now, during the winter monsoon, the winds blow from land to sea because there is a high pressure in the land and there is a low pressure in the sea. However, this reverses during summers when the land becomes hot and develops low pressure while the ocean remains cool and has high pressure. And it is because of this pressure gradient, or the difference in the pressure, that the winds start flowing from the high pressure zone to the low pressure zone. Now, this development of low pressure is mainly on account of the high insolation that is received at the Tropic of Cancer during the summer months. And as a result of which, we witness a differential heating and cooling of land and water. For land has the tendency to get heated up and to cool down faster than the ocean, as a result of which this insulation causes the land to get heated up while the water is still relatively cooler, because of which a low pressure area is developed over the land and a high pressure persists over the sea, because of which we witness a pressure gradient resulting in the monsoonal winds. Further, the other factor is with respect to the shifting of ITCZ. Now, ITCZ, which is also known as Intertropical Convergence Zone, which is basically a convergence zone between the northeast trades as well as the southeast trade winds. Now, this ITCZ is known to shift as per the movement of the sun. Now, this ITCZ shifts northwards during the summer while it moves southwards during the winters. And it is one of the most important factors that impacts Indian monsoons. Now, this shift of ITCZ is also related to the removal of jet stream. Now, the scientist community have suggested that there might be a shift between the ITCZ and the movement of the jet streams. So, it is believed that the shifting of ITCZ to the north is related to the withdrawal of western jet streams from its position over the northern Indian plains. Now, this is where the jet streams flow, and it is when the jet streams move towards the northern direction, it is the ITCZ that moves north towards the northern plains of India. Further, it is at the same time that the easterly jet streams moves across the India at around 15 degree latitude. And thus there has been an interconnection between the removal of westerly jet streams, arrival of ITCZ and arrival of easterly jet streams in the country. And it is because of these three factors that we witness burst of the monsoon during the month of June. Now let us try to see how La Nina and Indian Ocean Dipole affect the Indian monsoon. Now Indian Ocean Dipole basically refers to the irregular oscillation of the sea surface temperature in the Indian Ocean. Now, during the positive phase of the Indian Ocean Dipole, it is the Western Indian Ocean, as is reflected here, becomes warmer, while the Eastern Indian Ocean remains cooler. On the other hand, during the negative phase of the Indian Ocean Dipole, it is the Eastern part of the Indian Ocean that becomes warmer, while the Western part remains cooler. Now, it is the positive phase of the Indian Ocean Dipole that is good for Indian monsoon, as was seen in the 2020 above average monsoon. Further, this positive phase is known to bring droughts in South Asia and Australia. That is, it brings drought to this region while it brings rain to the Indian Peninsula. Further, the rain pattern becomes opposite with respect to the negative phase of the Indian Ocean Dipole, wherein the Indian Peninsula faces droughts while Australia and Southeast Asia face heavy rainfall. So, Indian Ocean Dipole is basically the developments that happen with respect to the difference in the pressures that occur in the Indian Ocean. Now, counter to this is the El Nino or the La Nina phenomena, which is a combined ocean as well as atmosphere phenomena. Now while El Nino is the warmer phase of the ENSO, that is El Nino Southern Oscillation Cycle, it is the La Nina that is the cooler phase of ENSO. Now, ENSO is basically a recurring climate pattern involving changes in the temperature of the water and alongside the parallel development in the upper stages of the atmosphere. That is, there is change in the temperature in the ocean, and because of which there are pressure differences, because of which we see a change in the air circulation pattern. And this combined effect is known as ENSO. Now, its warmer phase is El Nino and the cooler phase is El Nina. Now, it is the warmer phase that gives rise to drought in India, while it is the cooler phase that was witnessed in 2019 that gave rise to rainfall in India and the Indian Ocean subcontinent. Now, let us take up the 2017 question. The question read, with reference to Indian Ocean Dipole, sometime mentioned in the news, while forecasting Indian monsoon, which of the following statements are correct? Indian Ocean Dipole phenomenon is characterized by a difference in sea surface temperature between the tropical Western Indian Ocean and tropical Eastern Pacific Ocean. Now, clearly, Indian Ocean Dipole, as we have just studied, is only related to Eastern and Western Indian Ocean. It has no role with respect to Pacific Ocean. Hence, this statement is incorrect. Further, even had you not known about the Indian Ocean Dipole, the term itself is a hint, given it talks about only Indian Ocean, and hence this has to be incorrect. Now, the second statement says that an Indian Ocean Dipole phenomenon can influence an El Nino impact on the monsoon. Now, as we had studied, the Indian Ocean Dipole is basically a difference in the sea surface temperature within the Indian Ocean, while El Nino is both a difference with respect to sea surface temperature alongside atmosphere circulation. And since there is a common sea surface temperature that is affected in both these cases, thus it clearly affects monsoon. For suppose in an year there is IOD as well as El Nino, they both impact the ocean surface temperature and hence they will influence each other's impact on Indian monsoon. And hence this is a correct statement. So answer becomes B2 only. Now let us move to the next article. Now this article appearing on the page number 6 has been written in the context of recent announcement by the President of United States of America, Joe Biden, wherein he had suggested that the US will pull out of Afghanistan by 11th of September. Now this would mark an end of 2-decade war that US has been fighting in Afghanistan against the Taliban since the 2001 Twin Tower attack in America. Now this deal upholds the spirit of the Trump-Taliban agreement that was signed last year, wherein it has decided that the US troops will be pulled out of Afghanistan by 1st of September. And in exchange, it was decided that the Taliban would give assurance that they will not let other terrorist organizations such as Al-Qaeda, an Islamic State, to operate on the Afghan soil. So this was the Trump-Taliban deal that it seems like the Joe Biden president would continue to uphold. Further, as for the deal, even the other troops that were commanded by the NATO too would pull back along with the American troops. And hence this would make for a great development in India's neighborhood, which shall have huge geopolitical impact. To understand which in detail, please refer to the DNS dated 9th March 2021, wherein Mangal Sir had discussed in detail the counters of the end game in Afghanistan. Now in front of you is the answer for yesterday's question of the day. Now the answer for the National Pension Scheme question is option B2 only. Further, you also have the quiz question for the day. Please attempt this question and provide the answer in the comment section below.